Hello, good morning. Today is Wednesday, June 19, 2024, class 12 in the series on the pre-incarnative. Last week, I went into, not completely, but to some degree, 6816 on the page of 20 replies to Don's questioning about pre-incarnative matters. 6816 and the next one on the page, which is 677, are related. They're also related to the question exchange we had before, 7217, which in which Ra explained the mechanics, the metaphysical kind of mechanics or energetics of negative contact that was ongoing for Carla, but was particularly associated with some stratagem to lure her away, lure her out of her away, her, lure the mind complex away from the body, so that the entity could actually disable her body, thus kill her, and she thus would follow that entity voluntarily to negative 5D negative time space. And that's a whole long story, which is not, centered on the pre-incarnative, but on a post-incarnative and a danger. I was mistaken in that I had forgotten the fact that it wasn't during a raw session that this threat was in play, but while she was doing other spiritual work or being asked questions. I believe she had said she, if only Ra was with me, or if I could be with Ra, something where she wasn't being protected by Ra during a channeling or helping with students. And in that unprotected field of activity, not metaphysically protected by Ra because it wasn't during a session, it hadn't been, they hadn't done their protective ritual. Then, being in that less protected condition, mind complex, or quote, her, being tempted or basically deceived to voluntarily follow the negative entity away to help him, help, I need your help, that kind of ploy. It was that condition, not during a raw session. So, in 7217, we see that. By negative contact with that entity simply seeks out the distortions pre-incarnatively programmed and developed also in incarnative state. So negative entities work on exploiting pre-existing distortions and the weakest link in the chain normally is attacked first. And so low-hanging fruit. Is there are many human phrases that actually are of deep wisdom and indicate principles of operation or are in play in higher dimensions too, like take the low hanging fruit before you scramble to the top and try to take what's higher or more difficult. The negative entities actually focus on the weakest link in the chain, and as we'll see in the next exchange, actually after 6816, 677, which is a, in this, in a grouping here, negative entities will take what's easiest before they focus upon what's more difficult. If you can do it, with a little effort, do it. Start with what's easy and the low-hanging fruit. So, from 7217, we see that negative entity comes in the violet ray, and then was both activating green ray center, fourth chakra, as well as further blocking indigo, sixth chakra, and that was possible. Not only because Carla wasn't metaphysically protected when she was calling for Ra or calling for guidance out of, in a sort of disembodied or somewhat out of body state, but her pre-incarnative programming associated with her pre-incarnative development, right? It's a pre-incarnative condition that gives rise to specific programming. So based on her point evolution or the work that she and Don particularly had chosen to do in the incarnation and their personal work where he was working on, a tendency of wisdom over love and she was with a condition of love over wisdom, there was some kind of imbalance for each, like we all have imbalances of one or the other. the negative entity was able to activate Green Ray Center. So you could feel love from a negative entity. It doesn't mean the negative entity is loving you or loves. It means that the negative entity can intensify Green Ray. So be careful. Some, the devil in a blue dress or red shoes or something. Or, male or female. So there is high level negative action that without it without adequate Blu-ray wisdom discernment buddhi, viveka, we take as loving kindly because we're feeling good. So just because I feel good doesn't mean that person is positive or intending the best for us in any way. One must look in. Negatives are clever. And as Ross said in a follow-up to 6816 in session 68, 6817, which is not on this page of 20, Don was wondering why is the negatively polarized entity followed to the place of negative time space, meaning why would she ever do that? Why would one of us freely follow the entity? He asks. And Ra explains, again, it's just first level pass, saying, the positive polarity sees love in all things, the negative polarity is clever. Well, the well-developed positive polarity is very clever too, right? Harmless as dove, clever as snake, serpent, said Yeshua, I think. So this is love wisdom, wisdom and compassion. So those on the positive path are quite clever to the degree that they love truth and discernment and are willing to acknowledge qualities of mistakenness and take responsibility for lack of discernment, loving to know more and be free of confusion. Then the negative polarity is not the only one that's clever, the positive polarity is clever. So the positive polarity sees love in all things. Well, how about those that are seriously love over wisdom in development would see love in all things and only love in all things? That's a problem when you're facing those that willfully reject love, like those on the negative path, or those that are so psychologically damaged or tangled or psychopathological in some way or another, self-harming, self-hating, seriously damaged self-esteem, that they can't accept love either. And so, oh, it's okay, we love you. Oh, it's okay, we love you. That fails with some people who are not ready, or when they're not ready to accept love and kindness towards themselves. So they can't take it from you because they don't want to offer it to themselves or be in loving, open heart alone. It's too painful, or stuff comes up, or they feel they deserve to be punished, or something, guilt complex. So it's a problem seeing love in all things or seeing all things as love only. That's not the positive polarity includes nearby Atman, not only fourth density, seeing love in all things. So seeing love in all things also is a phrase that is unclear. And so trusting people, blanket trust is unwise, just like blanket mistrust is unwise. Walking around sourpuss is harmful, or being overly intellectual and endlessly thinking all the time because you think you need to is unhelpful and a blockage. So wisdom is a rather lonely matter, or so I think I read from Ra. It takes a whole lot of seclusion or solitude or inner work to disentangle our tangled beliefs and conceptualizations or interpretations of this and that. So wisdom is critical, and not only the negative polarity is clever, but for those that think the positive path or the path to awakening or freedom, absolute freedom, is only love, or aren't willing to see and consider the painful and the ugly, there's going to be a problem. So, and that bias is also associated with pre-incarnative programming, which is associated with the karmic stream or how people were developed up to the point of programming before the birth. So in 6816, Ra, again, not so heavily talking about pre-incarnative, explains the sequence by which the negative entity made deepened contact with Carla. That is actually explained even more fully, or in another from another angle in 67.7, which I also would like to finish today. 67. So in 68.16, Ra talks about this was before the other 72. So from session 67, 68, 72, these are critical questions about the negative entity attack or contact. It is attack, you know. There's a difference between kissing and slapping. So to say it's intending to hurt or to control, that could be called attack. So we can call it a psychic attack. To call it a greeting equates it with benign, loving, friendly hello. It's not that at all. So to call it a greeting, it's a contact. So be careful. I'm careful about wrongly shading interpretation, because in some sense it's inevitable. Some philosophers have talked about this, that there's some degree of manipulation or dishonesty in even a choice of words. There's some degree of control in the choosing of words, even when one doesn't intend to hurt or control or whatever, or deceive. I choose these words. Why? Well, particularly in relationship, people choose words that either minimally hurt or don't open cans of worms or are not triggering or are triggering, but even, intending to do no harm, ahimsa, we're careful in our choosing words sometimes in relationship. That could certainly be seen as a form of a moderate, mild dishonesty, but there's no other way. We have to choose words. And inevitably, we're choosing words in association with our deep beliefs and values. If do no harm is a deeply held value, that's nice, that's great. Then still there is some deliberate choosing of the best words or what's best to say, which is intending for something other than, not simply a complete transparent conveyance of a view or of an idea. So it's a there'll always be some manipulation for as long as eighth fetter is not broken. As long as there's a sense of self, there's going to be some kind of spin or shading to statement and communication, it seems. The very choice of words comes out of some degree of distortion associated with selfhood and intention, what I want in the communications, even if it's on the up and up, and I really want to be harmless and help maximally, there still is some kind of shading and decision of what I say and not say, and then it's always partial then. So in any case, that's a certain matter. The way that so we can say psychic greeting, but I would prefer psychic, attack or negative contact. So words are important because people further distort significance by their own, very unique ways of interpreting. So anyway, the first step for the negative entity, it becomes aware of power. This power was the power of LNL Group, the light power. It's a radiant field of light. It's a field, a spherical, radiant, multidimensional field of light. What light power is that? That light power has capacity of energizing those which may be available, different than who may be available, which may be available for harvest. People are entities, or entity as a thing and people as a subject, that's interchangeable, actually. So subject and object is one from the law of one, right? So they talk about people as that which may be energizing those which may be available for harvest, they may be available. And so the negative entity wants to disable the power source. It sends legions, temptations are offered, they're ignored or rejected. The power source persists and indeed improves interconnections of harmony and love of service. This is the story of Carla and LNL. And then, and that is explained in a little bit more detail in the next exchange, 67.7, where Don was trying to understand certain concepts. He's very difficult, difficult, difficult. poor questions, but they're not too poor. It says, it seems to me the fifth density entity is attracted in some way to our group by the polarization of this group, which acts somehow as a beacon to the entity. And yes, that's right. The beacon that the entity became aware of is explained in 68.16, which was the next session for him, but the previous exchange on the page. The entity becomes aware of power, a power that has the capacity of energizing those available for harvest, and doesn't want that. So negative entities, they love power. They love it. So Frank Underwood, FU, says power is higher than money, but you need a lot of money sometimes to do certain things as well. They love power. They love power. And so taking care of people is the last thing on politicians' minds, not even on the radar, I imagine, generally. So power, they love power. And the entity, the sequence in 67.7, which is sort of an expansion of a portion of 68, 68.16, is, Ross said. Don was wondering, is there a beacon? And Ross said, this is in substance correct, but the efforts of this entity are put forward only reluctantly. The usual attempts upon positively oriented entities or groups of entities are made, as we've said, by minions of the fifth density Orion leaders. These are fourth density. Minions of the fifth density leaders, so the leaders of Orion are 5D negative, their minions are 4D negative. The normal gambit, they go on, the normal gambit of such fourth density attack, they use the word attack, that's nice, is the tempting of the entity or group of entities away from total polarization towards service to others and towards aggrandizement of self or of social organizations with which the self identifies. Self-aggrandizement and organizational aggrandizement. In the case of this particular group, each was given a full range of temptations to cease being of service to each other and to the one infinite creator. Each entity, meaning Don, Jim, Carla, each entity declined these choices and instead continued with no significant deviations from the desire for a purely other self-service orientation, which again is very confusing because I'm so totally fixed on you, other self. Exaggerates the importance of relationship on the positive path. There is an adept path that is not so thickly relational. Anyway, they go on. At this point, one of the fifth density entities overseeing such detuning processes determined that it would be necessary to terminate the group by what you might call magical means, as you understand ritual magic. We've previously discussed the potential for the removal of one of this group by such attack, and have noted that by far the most vulnerable is the instrument, Carla, due to its, it, objectified, its pre-incarnative physical complex distortion. So 9 points of, 9 targets of opportunity. Body complex of Don Jim Carla, mind complex of each, spirit complex of each. The most vulnerable initially was body complex level body of Carla. Later, I think they worked heavily on the mind complex of Don, and continued working on body mind of Carla. And so, first, the low hanging fruit is sought, and then the 5D or so, thus, the 5D negative leaders of Orion use their troops of 4D negative Orion to tempt the entity or a group of entities, meaning an individual or a group as a collective, away from total polarization towards service to others, a total commitment to green, blue, indigo, a total commitment to love-based wisdom and development, or harmlessness and non-control and absolute radical honesty in self-development. That doesn't mean radical honesty with others is wise all the time, obviously not, but sometimes but for oneself, the most radical honesty is a great thing. It's very difficult, it's painful. We have guilt, shame, regret, remorse now and then about this and that. But the more honest one can be with oneself, the faster the path. And that's why meditation accelerates evolution or healing and balance. You know, let's say mindfulness meditation, like a Buddhist form of mindfulness. Other maybe, I don't know. But Buddhist mindfulness practice definitely accelerates evolution in that it disables default defense mechanisms, and people thus feel more and know more and are aware of more, particularly within the mind, within the self, and then are opened by the training of mind simply to pay attention steadily to one object without refusing any other experience, but also not grasping. So neither grasping nor aversion. What arises, arises. I'm here to watch this object of concentration, like the breath. This is a commitment to honesty. Actually, this is a commitment to sincere non-manipulation of one's own process. I'm just simply, I remember in meditation, I wondered, how could I be in such psychic distress by just simply sitting and watching my breath? It can't be that just doing this is causing this pain and agony I was going through in the early 20s, in the early 80s, 1980s. So no, I don't know. Sitting and watching breath is not a cause of misery or torment. But if misery and torment is experienced, it's probably because that stuff has been suppressed and repressed and is coming up into consciousness called catharsis. So, but the principle there is a commitment to non-manipulation of one's own mind, feeling process. And so, total polarization towards service to others is a total commitment, to do no harm and speak truth. And also, non-aggrandizement of self, because this total, you know, it's a difference between taking and giving, or grasping, both grasping and hating versus freely allowing. Freely allowing means if you don't follow me, that's fine. If you don't like me, that's fine. If you don't like this, that's fine. If you go away and never see me again, that's fine. Maybe I feel angst or maybe I don't, but I surely don't want to control and bring you and keep you and hold you. Because actually, you know, and that depends, right? I don't want to hurt you, maybe the motive. Or I don't want you around. I don't want people following me like that. So there are all sorts of motivations for non-aggrandizement of self or collect or social organization. Non-aggrandizement is what happens actually when one is more fully honest. Now, one may say, I want people to follow me, I want people to look up at me, I want people to this and that and, elevate me or idolize me or something. Okay, one could find that that's what one wants. Is that what one wants? That's part of what mind wants or I want. You see, even the language is all screwy, screwy, dooey, looey, because if I discover what had been hidden, oh, I secretly love them. I secretly want to aggrandize myself and my group. Or, oh yes, I really do want Rockefeller funding, like Daiwa Satsugat, or something something, or WEF support like Sadhguru gets, or something like that. Oh, I secretly want to be at the big boys' table, those ta that table. Oh, okay. Is that what I want? Quote, what I really want? Oh, I discovered what was hidden. That's what I really am. The discovery of what has been hidden is simply a single discovery within the field of what is far greater than that single discovery. Meaning, what I found that is my feeling or desire, let's say, or motivation. To say that that's the whole of what I really am is wrong. No, that's the counterpart to a false pretense given to the self or given to the world that I don't want something, let's say. Oh, I really want it. No, I really don't want it. The truth is, actually, we want all sorts of things. And if one is really honest, one will naturally go to the deeper levels of desire and longing. Well, there's what I enjoy for pleasure. There's what I need for meaning and value. That I must fulfill needs for meaning and purpose. Thus, I must know my deeper values to be able to fulfill those values, thus find meaning and purpose, or my purpose and meaning is the fulfillment of what I value, what is essential, not what is secondary, tertiary or peripheral. What is at the core is what will bring me the most fulfillment. That is a matter of, determining one's values. What's most meaningful is knowing value and fulfilling that somehow. And one would find that flowering a social organization or aggrandizing the reputation, social reputation, one's social reputation, are hollow Pyrrhic victories, hollow gains. It's a, fame. I mean, this is basically about fame. And so personal fame or organizational and personal fame. I'm famous. Famished. Yeah, famished in the family of fame. So, if one see if you know love truth is not just about I don't want to lie to you or me. It's actually a longing for deeper comprehension where it's deemed important, particularly myself and what I value and how much am I fulfilling my sense of purpose right now in my life. So, more centered self-seeking in the sense of self-knowing, seeking knowing of essentials, would lead one like they've done. That's how it is that they rejected temptations for aggrandizement of self or the group. Why? They were given a full range of temptations to cease being of service to each other and the one infinite creator, each declined the choices, and instead continue with no significant deviations from the desire for purely other self-service orientation. A pure desire or purely other self-service orientation means pure, continued, centered spiritual seeking. And in this case, it was being part of the L&L Research Group doing this work of surrendering personal desire or selfish, self-centered desire to be available for the contact, to do what's needed to keep the contact going, because they knew it was of highest value for themselves, and I would say so too. So they knew their own deeper, higher, greater values. They knew what was more meaningful and valuable for themselves, and that was this working. Thus, they declined the choices, continued with no significant deviations. Then, at this point, one of the fifth density, one of, there were several, at this point, one of the fifth density entities overseeing such detuning processes determined that it's necessary, would necessary to terminate the group by magical means, ritual magic. Terminate the group would be done by terminating any member of the group, and the weakest link was Carla's body by way of her mind, meaning exploiting her love of her wisdom, bias, or a tendency to cleverly deceive, like, oh, poor me, please help me, I'm in so much pain, please help me, please help me. The devil as devil as a cripple, tempting to kidnap the selfless server who sees all things as love and may not have been clever enough, or didn't value cleverness enough, perhaps, which is a preincarnative condition associated with unpreincarnative programming or life picture that offers opportunity to work through things. So, okay, one of the fifth density entities overseeing, so there were several, what were they overseeing was a detuning processes. So the normal gambit of 4D negative attack as tempting of entities or group of entities is a detuning. Detuning, retuning. Tuning, tuning, what tuning? I very much second chakra to sixth chakra by way of fourth chakra. 2, 4, 6 line tuning by way of wisdom. So by wisdom, one knows I'm out of tune. One knows that I must up wisdom and love. Or I want to stay true to what I know is essential. And that's what they did. Thus, they rejected the temptations. They were steadily well tuned, and thus not allow not accepting detuning. And that's what negative entities are all about, or bad people in one's life, liars, manipulators, narcissists, the whole gamut of harmful folks in this world, which is a big range. They offer the opportunity for us to detune ourselves by getting further by further distorting ourselves. Now, it's very difficult when somebody comes at us physically, violently, to not. What should we do? Should we not get angry? Should we not fight back? Should we not do something physical against them if they're physically attacking us? You got to figure that out too. All right? Defense of the beloved is a standard in 4D positive. So, what does defense of the beloved mean? And are you the beloved too? Defending yourself, is that not beloved? Is that selfish to defend yourself against physical attack? Is it selfish to defend yourself against verbal abuse or attack or maligning treatment or something? And what does it even mean, defend yourself? Right? Somebody says things because they want to hurt me, or this entity was trying to tempt them to self-aggrandizement, to vanity, to pride, to cult of per you're developing a cult of personality, which never happened with L&L. They never pushed it. Some people wanted to see Carla as a guru or something, but she wasn't pushing that actually. So she never tried to develop a cult of personality. They never were heavy-handed in trying to get people to be part of the organization. Never. Because they had something better, which is a sense that their well being true to themselves, staying tuned to what they know is centered and essential, which is non-harm, non-aggrandizement, honesty, non-manipulation of anybody. So they were when somebody comes at us, it's inevitable that we detune ourselves if we have a distorted reaction. And all I can say is that, for the greatest of the teachers, or Gautama Nityananda, they were attacked a couple of times, not too often. And there was a, straight back, a kind of thou shalt not, hand in the face, stop type of response. Nisargadatta got angry sometimes. I don't know if Nityananda got angry or Gautama. But I think Gautama once said, "You stupid fool," to some monk who made a problem. So maybe anger arises. What's the problem? I don't think anger is a problem. The question is, what do you say and do? And harsh speech, malicious speech may feel good as a venting, but it actually doesn't help much. Speaking some truth to the negative attack or to the attacker may be useful. Getting out of the way physically would be useful. Ending the relationship would be useful, or minimizing the relationship is useful. Putting them in their place with truth is useful. And anyway, detuning is very, it happens all the time. We depolarize or gets, whenever we're stuck, we can say we've been detuned by our own distorted responses. So that's what was going on. And then 68:16, to clarify and complete that, the negative entity, the 5D negative, determined it must attempt the disabling itself, and did its best again to work on to basically to terminate the group by killing Carla physically, by first exploiting a love over wisdom distortion imbalance in mind. So pre-incarnative plan for Don and Carla was their relative placement, one greater in wisdom, the other greater in love, or blue ray, green ray, yang and yin and yang. That was a pre-incarnative decision to embody that polarity in a somewhat polarized, imbalanced way. Wisdom over love, love over wisdom, sure, no problem. But then there was also the pre-incarnated programming of bodily tendencies, or bodily illnesses that are potential, the latent potential for certain body problems of Carla. That's why it would be easiest to work on her body to kill the body, but that needed to be done by the mind so that she could get out of the way and not have protection. And that was done by that clever gambit of while she was somewhat out of body and mistakenly called for Ra, or called sincerely, but was unprotected metaphysically, thus vulnerable. That was determined to be the most the mid-hanging fruit, or what was next up available for the 5D negative entity. So I have no doubt that that's a true story, and that just shows you that, I mean, how many people read the raw material, right? 10,000, 100,000, 200,000? How many people got it deeply? I don't know. 5,000, 10,000, 20,000? So a 5D negative entity gets very intimately involved with a human being and a human group from very far away, simply because of this, while their effect is only 50,000, 20,000, 50,000, 100,000 people, yeah, because the light was that strong. And they had certain vulnerabilities, more than yogis in the forest, who may have comparable light or greater light, radiant power, but are much less vulnerable because of the wall of light, as Ralph said. In 68:16, this wall of light of six chakra, which is not a wall but simply a field of light in the head from six chakra, seventh chakra, activation and correlation, or coordination of six and seven makes that light of head, which acts as wall for negative entities that are coming in through violet ray somehow. The sixth chakra, sixth ray, sixth subplane, sixth subplanes of the chakras themselves, 2.6, 3.6, is of greater light radiant power, thus acts as a wall or a defense or a protection against undesirable entry. So, anyway, all of that is quite heavy. It's all related to the preincarnative. Nearly nobody else understands that in this. I don't think there are any other. I've never seen another metaphysical teaching that explains this in such detail. Psychic attack, positive, negative contact in such metaphysical chakra yogic detail, as well as the sequence of how negatives seek to gain power by a sort of s phases of a gambit of an approach, working on what's easier, and then targeting what's more difficult later if that fails. So let me see the time, 41. And that completes the three. These three of sessions 672, 68, 67. Very detailed understanding of psychic attack and the manipulation of psychic attack that exploits pre-programmed distortions or pre-programming where there's imbalance or a tendency to imbalance or long-term distortions, which are, all related, distortion, imbalance. But imbalances of a polarity, distortion is of the point, each point of that polarity, and thought can be very distorted. So that's enough for that, I think. When we move along to the next exchange, we have 7319, and it's the third to the end of the series of 20. So we're getting very close to the end of the series. And this is about healing. And so it's very interesting. So first, we just were talking about negative attack, psychic attack, negative entity attack, and the preincarnative. Here we're talking about deep self-healing and the preincarnative. And so in both cases, the physical and the metaphysical are inseparable, as Ross said. And so physical healing is associated with preincarnative programming and preincarnative conditions, the soul, the being before birth. And likewise, for a healer and for one who wishes for healing, greater healing, of course, nobody really agrees on what even the definition of healing means, right? Ask 10 healers, what is a healer? You'll get 10 different answers with some overlap and some divergence. Who means what? You better ask more. You don't want to ask more. You probably won't know exactly what they mean, what they think they're doing, what they think they're doing. So, the Tower of Babel is Kalpana itself, concept, generation of thought form. An imperfected identity bound awareness, a self, a speaker with who's not finished Ahamkara or eighth fetter or Anatta, has gotten to understanding of non-duality at some sense or taste of non-duality. It produces distortion in thought form regularly, and thought form itself, because it's partial, it gives only partial comprehension and is commonly taken as total. It's concept itself partially, inevitably only partially reveals and explains, but it's commonly taken as total or complete in the presentation or understanding of the nature of what's being discussed. and it's not. So don't take the impermanent to be permanent. Don't take the partial to be complete. Yet Ra talks about complete and whole and perfect. Well, that's law of one or higher self, complete and whole and perfect. What does that mean? You see, if you don't think deeply, you won't know deeply. And very few people want to think deeply because very few people, because they're not going to get an audience. People say, man, that's too weird. Just, I want to hear something easier. Sure, me too. Me too. But I'm very aware that very few people can explain themselves well. If you push anybody to explain him herself well, you'll be surprised how little they can do. So, okay. 7319, Don asks, says, I'll make a general statement which you can correct. So bear in mind, we're not only getting to the end of this page, we're now in the 70s. And the next question is 8516. So very late in the contact, much, much water under the bridge. Don has become very sophisticated in questioning here, actually. He said, the way I see the overall picture of healer and patient is that the one to be healed has, because of a blockage in one of the energy centers or more, but we'll just consider one particular problem, because of this energy center blockage, the upward spiraling light that creates one of the seven bodies, or all of them, has been blocked from maintenance of that body, energy field, and this has resulted in a distortion from the perfection of that body, which we call disease or body anomaly, which is other than perfect. The healer, having suitably configured its energy centers, is able to channel light, the downward pouring light, seven down, through its properly configured energy situation, chakras, and coordination to the one to be healed. If the one to be healed has the mental configuration of acceptance of this light, the light then enters the physical complex and reconfigures the distortion that was created by the original blockage. I'm sure I've made some mistakes in that. Would you please correct them? So, yeah, they're very minor. And Ross said, your mistakes were small. We would not at this time attempt a great deal of refinement of that statement, as there's preliminary material which will undoubtedly come forward. We may say that there are various forms of healing. So you see, now we're getting to deeper levels of the discussion of the meaning of the word healing. Healing is stratified or a complex matter where there are forms and levels. So there are various forms of healing, and not only in technique. They go on. In many, only the energy of the adept is used. In the exercise of fire, some physical complex energy is also channeled. So this is technique. Then they go on. We might note further that, and this is most important, actually, very relevant to all of us and everyone we know to some degree, very likely. They said, we might note further that. When the one wishing to be healed, though sincere, remains unhealed, as you call this distortion, you may consider pre-incarnative choices, and your more helpful aid to such an entity may be the suggestion that it meditate upon the affirmative uses of whatever limitations it might experience. We would also note that in these cases, the indigo ray workings are often of aid. So, when one whose wishes to be healed, though sincere, remains unhealed. Because we're talking about healing, no healing, we're talking about unhealed physical complex conditions, I think. Not only sincere, how about working hard, going to healers, doing affirmation, doing this, that, and the other thing, not doing too much. Eating, sleeping, this, that, and the other thing, doing all the right things. And even not even doing too much. You can do the right things, you can do too much of good things, and that's the wrong thing. The right things, good things must be done in the right proportion. Not only good things done endlessly or maximally. Maximal doing can be a further distortion because it indicates lack of faith. Or it comes from a sense that I've got to force this. On the other hand, one can think it's all effortless, just say it and it'll be done, and it doesn't happen, because that's a futile principle. That's not a true principle either. So one could be sincere in wishing to be healed, one could be very diligent and even not too diligent, not excessive in continuing self-helping activities and still remain unhealed. Why? Well, in general, I think it probably is mainly because of pre-incarnative choices. It's not in the cards that that physical condition will heal. It's not in the cards that you're going to be able to heal that physical condition. You got to face it and make your best shot at treatment and what's best. There's a pre-incarnative decision to, but you see you got to be sure that you've done everything, and one has to, it's not just though sincere remains unhealed. The one wishing to be healed, though sincere, remains unhealed. So it's not simply the non-healing of a sincere seeker of healing who has a wounding, physical or mental. It's actually they've done maximally, in balance, all that they know they can do for that physical, mental healing and remain unhealed, physically or mentally. Then I would say yes, it was a pre-incarnative choice to experience that for the lifetime or for as long as it remains. I had a client many, 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 many years ago in Bloomington, you know who you are, who had some kind of serious body problem. I'm not even sure what. It was really heavy, heavy. Year in, year out, she worked, she tried, she did. She was very sincere and effortful. Not just sincere, she made great effort. She made balanced effort. And it didn't go away, didn't go away, couldn't heal, couldn't heal, couldn't heal. Someday, somehow, out of the blue, somehow, somebody mentioned to her vitamin D injection or something like that. She did it, and ba-boom, it was gone. Just like that. Was it inadequate seeking that kept it going so long? Was it excellent seeking that got her that solution that came, naturally? I would imagine it's pre-incarnative to have that condition, for her to have had that condition. As a challenge to greater self-love, do you really want and value taking care of yourself? Or do you think you're less important than other people? If you think you're less important than other people, you'll have sickness and illness and pain because you're not taking care of yourself because you think you don't deserve it. So, meanwhile, I would imagine she either, it might not have been. See, this is where we really don't know. I don't know. Was it intended? It was. If it's intended to be lifelong, it's lifelong. And you can say if it's lifelong, it may be intended to be lifelong, but it's not that simple because there are lifelong conditions that people didn't well address. Well addressed means quantity quality. How well do you address the problem? How much effort and action is being put into addressing the problem? There's action, physical, mental, and then there's non-action, or just taking responsibility, the inner portions of healing, accepting, understanding, forgiving, knowing deeply what this is all about, how I made it, and why I made it, how I made it. That wasn't because I want to hurt myself, or maybe it was I want to hurt myself, but now I don't. I realize I, while I've done these things because I'm angry at myself, at a deeper level of my seeking, I find, in fact, I don't want to hurt myself. I feel terrible that I hurt myself, and didn't adequately seek my healing of this or that, or got myself into these situations where this trouble ca came, because at some level I was self-punishing. So. It's a matter of accepting what we find, but acknowledging that we may be seeking and not finding, or seeking and finding, and the conditions don't heal. And that's, as I'm saying, is completely very complex, and this is just scratching the surface. And Roz said they're more helpful, you're more helpful aid to such an entity, the one that is sincere and remaining unhealed. may be the suggestion that it meditate upon affirmative uses of the limitations, whatever limitations it might experience. So, affirmative use of the limitation. The limitation as a whole, the specific limitations, fine. Affirmative uses of limitation. And that's exactly I Ching teaching, hexagram 60, chia. Limitation in proper measure is limitation in proper measure furthers galling limitation should not be persevered or persisted in. So there's a difference between mild and moderate limitation and severe and extreme limitation. Severe and extreme limitation has the potential to make long-term physical mental damage. Long-term, mild or moderate limitation is more easily used well, more easily likely to be able to be, one would be able to use well the mild and moderate limitation. Because there's a lot of stuff we have to do or we know we want to do, though we don't like to do. Like that. So, affirmative uses of the limitations. There are all sorts of people with all sorts of physical conditions that are not going to be healed in this lifetime. There are all sorts of people with all sorts of mental conditions, psychological conditions. Me too, you too. We have lower triad blockage. We have, harmful patterns or wrong beliefs, of course. That won't be resolved before death. After death, it'll all be clear, but before, we'll go to our grave with certain imbalances, certain blockages, certain distortions, certain, seeds of distortion. Of course. Of course. Anybody who thinks, I'm going to die fully purified, doesn't know what 3D incarnation on Earth is all about. It doesn't happen that way. So, the whole point is that there's a piece of work to be done here. We're not here. You see, the materialists have no understanding, and the religionists have a very shallow understanding commonly, too, why we're here. So, affirmative uses of limitation. Because we're here for a short time and then we return to whence we came, to where we came from. From whence we came. Returning to from where. Returning to there for from where we came. The joys and sorrow, the gain and loss, the pleasure pain, is exists in the context of metaphysical purpose. And metaphysical purpose, the purpose of evolution is the purpose of incarnation, Ross said, is mind body spirit evolution, evolution of mind body spirit. That's the purpose of incarnation, the purpose of 3D incarnation to learn the ways of love. It's not We're not here for no purpose, we're here for much purpose. And religionists don't understand reincarnation generally. Western Abrahamic religions don't generally, so they have no idea really. They don't even know if there's an afterlife, and most of them die confused in the Abrahamic traditions. Most do. And Buddhist Hindu, they have their own issues too. And we're all limited in knowing. So, what we see as what indeed is painful and what is of loss and pain, two of the harsh worldly winds, can only be understood if one knows that they can be understood. That there we can trace the causality. But the causality itself exists within a larger perspective. Karmic law exists for the purpose of evolution of mind body spirit. There is a mind body spirit, not just a personal sense of self that dies with the body. So, anyway, we know that it's very, accepting what we can't change, right? The good and the true and the beautiful, it may be very ugly, our condition or our feeling or our pre-incarnative limitation, It may be very unpleasant or very painful to bear, but indeed is the case. I mean, that's just the only way I can understand it. When one has maximally, sincerely worked to heal and the healing doesn't happen, then one might consider, by way of wisdom, fifth ray, and indigo ray, spiritual inclusion, including the multi-incarnational, the multi-dimensional in this, in one's pondering, one may realize that for one reason or another, learning to live with this unhealable condition of mind or body is part of what I wanted to do when I came here, is part of what I want to do in my being here. In my being here, part of what I want to do is to meet this very unpleasant condition of pain or limited function with as much kindness and wisdom as possible. You know, the purpose of painful catalyst or upsetting and limiting catalyst, so-called, is the development, you know, the soul development associated with right response. We choose particular catalyst, we choose particular experience as catalyst to facilitate and accelerate our development of certain qualities, which in this case are developed by right response to that painful, difficult catalyst. That's the plan. And, you know, materialists can't accept that. They don't want to accept it. And that's another matter, is that a lot of people here don't know because they don't want to know, because they don't want to feel the consequences of acceptance and acknowledgement of some other truth, some greater truth, or personal truth. So, in any way, all right, that is as it is. It just simply does happen a lot that sincere and even well-balanced, effortful people who are making well-balanced efforts at self-healing or developing beyond a limitation can't do it. It doesn't go away. Then there's pre-incarnative. But it depends on what you're talking about, you know? So it's very personal and very intimate, actually, because it's about the meaning of particular body pathology. And that's where it's very useful to know the facial chakras and the limbs, the four limbs association with 2, 3, 4, 5 chakras. So, okay, that'll be about it for today. It's kind of a slugfest. So 102, 58, 103. Next week, back to basically a kind of higher working 8516 from where we started, where 59.3, close to the top, Jim's question about his own process. 85, really. 85.16, second to last, from in the series here of 20, is a question from Jim about pre-incarnative choices and his own process. So I hope this was helpful. We're coming to the end of this class soon. Take good care of yourselves, as always. Thank you for listening, and see you again soon. Good night.